Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Well, welcome to this session. I know you've all come to listen to Ajit. I don't know why I've been chosen to talk with him, because I'm the most tech-challenged person in this entire audience, to the extent that I don't even have a Facebook page, personal page of my own. I have a public page. But I also say yes to these things because every time I learn a lot. So Ajit, we are here to learn.
Thank you for having me. And Shekhar, I'm very skeptical when you say you don't know anything, but we'll go with that for now.
Well, I think we Delhi journalists actually pretend to know everything about everything, but this one is, I'd rather not go in that direction. So Ajit, Facebook. Now, I may not know anything about Facebook, using Facebook, technologies, but I do know that Facebook is a big headline globally, not so much in India actually. So why is Facebook such a big headline, so polarizing? Why? I mean, there are many other tech platforms. For example, Google, that's very big, but that doesn't draw the same attention. Google, Amazon, why Facebook?
I suspect Shekhar for three reasons. I think if I think about it, one, obviously, I think Facebook is now fairly large and consequential and used widely around the world. I think it's about 2.8 billion users who use the Facebook family of apps every month around the world. That's fairly consequential.
That's almost a half of all human beings.
That's right. And therefore, I think it's fair that there should be scrutiny on a company that is so deeply embedded into the social fabric of societies around the world. I think the second reason is Facebook has made mistakes in the past. And if I look back 2 or 3 years ago, And that started, I think, the conversation about Facebook linked to essentially access for third-party developers, which was not intended. And even though some of the practices, you know, Cambridge Analytica has now become a label, and although it violated Facebook's own policies, I do think the company has acknowledged that there were fundamental assumptions that third-party developers would behave in some ways and adhere to our policies that didn't work out. So I think the fact that mistakes were made, and I'm sure we'll talk about it, coming into the company a year ago, one of the things I've noticed is the extent to which there is an effort to correct the mistakes and create a new roadmap that is a lot more focused on privacy. But the fact that mistakes were made, I think, is the second reason. And I think the third is, on the back of that, Facebook today is quite a different company than it was 2 years ago. And part of being different is we are very keen to think through what the new rules of the internet should be. I think the internet operated for the first 15 or 20 years without a lot of traffic rules, without a lot of guidelines or guideposts. And I think there was a moment 2 years ago, at least for us, where we recognized that that can't be the way forward and we need to do it differently. And it's not just us. Digital players do need to think about it differently. And I think to your question, Shekhar, I think we have been very overt and leaning forward on articulating some of our views, which I think brings additional spotlight on us. So I think it's a combination of all three. Why there's so much scrutiny on us.
So I'm interested in you saying that internet grew without rules for a long time. But wasn't that intrinsic to internet's growth? That it was essentially an anarchic business. And it thrived in anarchy. Now, once you put it under rules, once you build in the bureaucrats, lawyers, activists, then internet loses what was so unique about it. Which is, it was an anarchy and a complete democracy.
The democracy, yes. And I think there are two different parts to it, right? And I think a lot of people in this audience would obviously associate with that, that if you look at history, this has been true whenever there's been big technological innovation or disruption. The early years of that disruption has invariably been followed by frenetic activity without clear guidelines. I think it's been true for every new technology that's had a positive impact on the world, and the internet was no different.
Well, the gold rush is a good example.
Yeah, and I think to some extent, Shekhar, I think you're framing it as gold rush and anarchy. I'm framing it as that explosion of innovation was positive. It created entirely new economic models that the world hadn't seen before. And whether it benefited from the absence of new rules or whether, like at different stages in the world's development, you're not in a position to develop the new rules until the fog clears out a bit, and you're really aware of the tremendous positive impact, and then a moment comes when you realize that okay, there needs to be some rules put in place. So to your point, I actually think the next stage of the growth of innovation will benefit from new rules being put in place, will benefit from regulation, but the point that you're making is obviously the risk always is, do you go the other extreme? And I think through the conversations we are having, and I think the company is leading, we can find a place where there are new rules, new guidelines, and yet the stage for continued innovation and growth.
So let me ask you, first of all, why are so many nations so anxious, or governments so anxious? And second, why is the liberal or liberal left community so anxious, or why is the Guardian so angry?
I think, Shekhar, you would probably know more about journalists and newspapers than I ever will. So at some point, I want to ask you that question.
You why have is the data, Guardian I don't.
So, why is the Guardian so angry? But I think to your question about both news media as well as governments, I do frame it in the context of it's a moment in time. And I think we have seen this in terms of the response to new technology and new disruption coming out of technology, where it's very celebratory in the beginning, sometimes overly so, and then it kind of swings to the other extreme where there's a lot of fear. And I think it does feel like, you know, if you've looked at a lot of the coverage over the last 15, 20 years, I think it went through that same cycle of extreme sort of celebration to now probably going to the other extreme of fear and concerns. And my hope is that the pendulum will come to the middle, a more balanced place. And therefore, I think it's completely right for governments to think through this and say, we can see sort of a lot of the disruption that has come our way on the back of it. But if there are opportunities to correct, you know, sort of some of the harm that may come, I think it's a very valid conversation to say there should be scrutiny, there should be new rules, and I think obviously governments are in the right place to frame the rules for the countries that they manage.
So are you, is Facebook putting in the correctives, or is it sort of putting in the chill pills to calm these anxieties?
I think it's a great question, and you know, I came into the company a year ago, maybe 2 years into sort of the big controversy around Cambridge Analytica. And my observation, Shekhar, is really two things. One, the sincerity to change is real. I don't think it's a chill pill. I don't think it's a reaction to enhanced scrutiny. It is not the same company as it was 2 years ago. And what I see is a lot of sincerity in thinking through some of the tough challenges and trying to find the right answers. And I think one evidence that it is not a chill pill solution is that we are actually being very forward and articulate about the positions we are taking, where I think if the approach was to lie low, I suspect the better answer would have been to be a lot less vocal about how we are thinking about it including some of the principles on freedom of expression and being very in the news and very front-footed about articulating it. And the second is, I think there's also recognition that on many occasions, once you go down this path, it's raising very difficult principles in terms of how do you make the trade-offs. So there is clearly a trade-off between security and privacy and the legitimate demand from governments for issues related to national security. So I do think we're trying to get our head around it, and I think all the tech companies are trying to get their head around it. And for me, I would frame this as we're now in that stage where we are trying to set the new rules of the internet and the relationship between citizens, tech companies, and governments. And I think it is right that we are a part of that conversation, and it's right that we put ourselves at the front and say we have points of view on this. And we have thought through some of this, and we are continuing to think through many others that remain unresolved.
So you are fundamentally a transnational medium that goes over national borders. How will you change now for a situation where different countries have different rules or laws?
I think it's a great question, and I think it's a tough one for which I'm not sure whether there's an easy answer for us. And obviously, I think when we look at it, and for me, you know, even if I look at it from the lens of what do I, as an Indian citizen, think is good for India, I happen to agree with it. Some of it, sort of my own experiences in my life, having lived here, lived outside, and come back here. We clearly believe that it is in the interest of a country like India to have rules in place, but also allow for the movement of knowledge and data and the work that is done on the data. And therefore, and not just India, it's in the interest of other open societies like India as well. And therefore, it is in the interest of at least the critical countries. Clearly, the United States is one, Europe is one. We believe India is a big part of sort of setting the rules of the new internet. It will help everyone, as well as the agenda of continued innovation. If there is some alignment between different regulatory regimes on how these rules work when it comes to the handshakes between them. And I don't think we are saying it just because our business is global. I think it is the right answer as well, that there is clarity about the handshake between different regimes and clarity about how data and knowledge moves across national boundaries.
So I'll keep conversing with him, but at any point of time, any of you has a question or intervention, please raise your hand, please go ahead. Because the deal is not that I will later say 5 minutes left, I'll take two questions, so please join in. Please wait for the microphone. Tell us your name.
My name is Rana. Indo-Nordic Strategic Association is a think tank I have. In Facebook, in India, do you have any post-editing facility undertaken here, similar to what you do in Germany and other places?
Will you clarify what you mean by post-editing?
Which areas do you think is not acceptable? Whenever...
Or do you filter any content?
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly.
Understood. Okay. Facebook has community guidelines around the world, and those community guidelines are global. For example, there are guidelines that limit free speech. There are guidelines that limit pornography, and that's for India as well.
Those are not customized for different nations. They are global.
Yeah. It's global. And those apply to India as well. So to the extent that any kind of pornographic content or hate speech goes up in India as much as it goes up in Germany, if it violates Facebook's community guidelines that are public, that are up for scrutiny, I think we evolve it based on inputs from stakeholders. Those apply in India as well. When you understand, when you say facility, there are two parts to it. Okay, got you. Two parts to it. One part it is a lot of the content gets picked up by AI systems and automated systems even before they get published or get distribution. So I think, the question kind of mentions that there are people looking at it. It's true, and I'll come back to the second part. But a lot of the hard work is done by AI, and as you can imagine, it's gotten better in the last 2-3 years, and there is work to get that better, because the idea is that hopefully you should be able to limit it from going online even before it's published, even before it's get any distribution. Second, there are people around the world, including in India, who do work on content review based on the guidelines after the engines have picked it up, and where some manual choices may need to be made.
So before I go to the next questioner, let me ask you a question. A lot of the new controversies and questions that have been raised, particularly in India, which concerns us, but elsewhere also, is about encrypted communication systems that you run. WhatsApp in this case. Yeah. Do you think that's been a liability now for Facebook to have gotten into it? Because Facebook, whatever it is completely open.
No, I don't. I think it's an enormous privilege for us to have WhatsApp. And I think if you've looked at our articulation over this year, Shekhar, one of the things that we have publicly come out and said is on messaging, we are doubling up on privacy. And core to it is our belief in end-to-end encryption. I think WhatsApp is used by billions of users because it is the leading end-to-end encryption platform. And the belief is for users around the world and for every Indian that the communication on messaging should be private, should be secure. Users should be aware that what they're communicating to their friends and family is secure. And I think governments around the world, and I think the government of India articulated a few weeks ago that they're very supportive and make sure that there is focus on the privacy of Indian users, and we agree with that. I think at the same time, we also recognize when you look at the family of apps as Facebook as a company, that as much as we have a WhatsApp, which is a private messaging platform, we also have the equivalent of a town square, a more social, more open forum, which is the Facebook app. And we believe that both are important and different from each other. So our belief is on private messaging, as well as on the continuation of Facebook as the place for more open conversations that are not meant to be private. And we believe it coexists, and it depends on the context of the users, which app that they use. And it's not just our family of apps, it's many other apps that provide that same proposition, either on the private messaging front or a more public forum.
So this Pegasus and NSO business, which got us also head up. Are you confident that you've been able to clean that problem up and there isn't any detritus left?
I think it's two parts to it, and I'll answer the question. I'm not trying to avoid it. It feels like I have to explain what happened a bit. I think, Shekhar, I know that you've spent a lot of time thinking through it, so you know the details, but just for those who were not tracking it closely, sometime in May, WhatsApp figured that an Israeli company was attempting a cyber attack, which was leveraging fundamental vulnerabilities in the operating systems on the phone. And WhatsApp kind of pushed back the attack. And at the same time, we recognized that there were about 1,400 users impacted around the world who were the target of these attacks. And we thought it the right thing was to call NSO, the company that was attempting to do this, for them to have accountability for what they were trying to do, which was targeted WhatsApp users, although the vulnerability they were leveraging came from the operating system. And therefore, there's a court that we have. There's a case we have filed in the courts in California, in the U.S. We fixed the whatever we could do. We don't control the operating system. We have fixed whatever we could do from a WhatsApp point of view. At the same time, Shekhar, I think, as you know, this is an ongoing game. I think there will always be actors who try and breach secure fortifications. And part of the reason why we believe that end-to-end encryption is so critical to pushing back against sort of actors like NSO trying to breach the privacy of users. And I think our commitment is to keep looking out for them, keep raising the bar on technology. And I think that's true for technology companies around the world. I think there is a bit of a cat and mouse game here. And what we can do is keep raising the game and be on the alert.
Well, this is classical electronic warfare. I think the militaries, that's why they have terms like electronic warfare, electronic countermeasures, electronic countermeasures. So this goes on. Ongoing problem. Sir, we'll come to you. The lady there. And then I think you raised your hand in the previous session also.
Good afternoon. Thank you, both of you, for such a wonderful discussion. My question is...
Please tell us your name and what do you do?
My name is Kirtan. I work for the World Bank and I work on blockchain. So naturally, my question is about Libra. The narrative around Libra from the beginning has been providing digital financial services to the unbanked, mostly in sub-Saharan Africa and MENA region. But there's always been confusion around the underlying assets behind Libra. As you know, for the unbanked, having liquidity and stability of currency is the number one factor. So I would like to hear your comments on that. There's still no clarity on what are the underlying assets for Libra. And moving forward, what do you think will be Libra's role in digital financial services in India, where Google Pay, Amazon Pay, Paytm have already become major players? Do you think that it's already an oversaturated market? Thank you.
Yeah, I think there were two, three. Sorry, you want to take one more question?
Let's take both.
My question. Yeah. My name is Harsh Manglik, formerly chairman Accenture India. And I'd like to first say, very interesting, and I really commend your candor with which you've been tackling difficult questions. I'm going to put you on a spot a little, right? And it's meant in the spirit of bringing out the truth. So, as you might imagine, I think I'm pretty tech savvy. I read a lot, so I understand some of the implications, which is what makes me afraid. Well, I should say I'm also dabbling in the academic world a little bit, Carnegie Mellon in the US, Indian School of Business. So here's a personal truth in lending declaration. By election and choice, I'm not on Facebook. My family are enthusiastically on it, and when I point out the issues as I see them, they say, oh yeah, but we are getting enough value, etc. They have these rules. But the fundamental
reason... Sir, the question, yes.
Thank you. The fundamental reason I'm not on Facebook is an issue of trust, right? And in your role and in the larger role of the company, it's a big hill to climb. And I'm very curious that from the perspective of the leadership, how do you intend to address that? That's the question. Thank you.
I think both questions, yeah. That one was about Libra and blockchain, yes.
Yeah. I think if I respond to this first, and you know, thank you for that question. Just to overtly pander to you, Accenture was a partner of mine when I was in Hotstar. So I think your teams used to do fabulous work for me. I think to the question that you asked, I think two parts to it. On the question of trust, I don't think there's anything more important to Facebook as a company than maintaining trust or restoring trust of users who, on the back of the narrative over the last 3 years, may be trusting us less than they used to. And I would so far as go out there and even say that even beyond restoring trust being the right thing to do for the company, especially a company that is focused on getting it right for the long term, I think we have an economic incentive to get it right on trust. a lot of times I think questions are raised about, you know, is the economic structure of the company misaligned with the agenda of trust? And the factual point to it is they both are extremely aligned. And therefore, I think you should know to where I started that the amount of time and energy from a thinking point of view that goes inside the company and from a resource point of view that goes from an investment point of view is all about as we reimagine the new world and as we think about the new rules, how do we make sure that we as a company are doing everything possible to maintain the trust of users? And for us, you know, that goes in many things, right? I think just to give you an example of things that we have done that I think go beyond even what is in the law, one of the things we rolled out is something called Off Facebook Activity, where we disclose, you know, it's quite common in terms of how the internet is run for many private institutions to give data to companies like us. We give the option of to users to say, here is what the data that may have been given by other partners from third parties. A lot of the restraints that we have put as part of our FTC settlement, the consent agreement, is really thinking through what are the restraints that we can put on ourselves, including making sure that every new product feature or a product launch goes through the scrutiny of are we doing it right if we apply the lens of privacy of users. So I think trust is extraordinarily important. I would also say that, you know, the fact that 2.8 billion users around the world use our family of apps means that a lot of users around the world understand or believe that we are doing the right thing. But I don't want to point to that number as the only reason. It's seriously understood in the company. And someone like you who may not be using the Facebook app, hopefully is using Instagram or WhatsApp because you fundamentally are overweight on private messaging. And we recognize that. Not all users would come in and use each one of our family of apps. And therefore, the recognition that there are some people who may gravitate more towards the use of a more public open forum and some more towards the use of private messaging. To the earlier question, I'm wise enough to know that I should not debate with a World Bank expert on blockchain. But I want to address one part of the question that you asked. And I think you know that Libra is not open in India, is not allowed in India at the moment, I think that's where it is. I do want to call out, because I think you were combining two different things, the conversation on cryptocurrency as well as the conversation on payment services like Google Pay. I think I am where Nandan was yesterday in his articulation of the opportunity associated with WhatsApp Pay using the UPI stack, that we do believe that WhatsApp Pay, just given the scale of users on WhatsApp today, which is more than 420 million users in India, that as Nandan, who has championed UPI and I think was one of the architects of UPI, essentially look at it and say, if we see UPI as good for India, and we believe that is the case, and if we believe that it furthers the agenda of financial inclusion, which we wholeheartedly believe it to be the case, we agree with Nandan's take that WhatsApp Pay going live is one of the biggest fuelers of UPI and people being able to use the movement of money easily. So I'm excited about it. I do genuinely believe one of the big things that we as a company can do is to enable the agenda of financial inclusion. By no measure do we believe that we are the only company who can contribute to it. I think for an agenda such as financial inclusion, and there are different parts to it, which I assume, which I know you would know, given where you said elements of bringing people in who are unbanked, lowering the cost of financial services, lowering the cost of transactions. I think on all of it, there is a dramatic role that we can play through WhatsApp Pay, just like many others are playing a very affirmative role. I think that's good for India and good for the agenda of financial inclusion.
The last question in the back from there, yes.
I'd like to to ask, based on...
Please tell us your name and what you do.
Yes, Asma from the Chennai Center for China Studies. I'm a researcher there. I would like to ask, based on the future of India's digital economy, what would be the future of competition between data-driven companies? What are your perspectives on that?
One more question? Or
no, I think there's enough.
Okay.
Because we'll be out of
time. You know, it's such a wide question. I know, given you're a researcher, there must be different parts to it. But fundamentally, as I think we have seen over the last 15, 20 years, there is an extraordinary amount of competition in the digital space, including in India. And I think, you know, we believe that level of competition is good. We see, you know, multinational companies doing very well in India. We see local companies doing well both in India and abroad. And no surprise, I think, given our own history, we do believe that, you know, a small company should have the opportunity to come in without, you know, and start with a baseline of zero and build successful, thriving enterprises. And competition is a good thing to make sure that happens, both for companies, for economic value, and for users around the world.
Our time's up, Ajit, but since I'm the moderator and there is lunch after this, I presume, so I can steal 2 minutes from that. I know that this is a question you will hear often and you must have a rehearsed answer. So you can give that, but as honest as you can. Where exactly does India figure in Facebook's scheme of things? And what exactly are you trying to achieve in India? What's your target in India?
No, and I'll,
is it numbers?
Yeah.
Is it money?
Yeah.
Is it influence? What is it?
I'll be very direct and non-rehearsed, and hopefully all my answers have been non-rehearsed.
Well, my questions
I rarely get tough questions
so.
Like this, so I couldn't have rehearsed them. I think it's an important one, Shekhar. Just to be very overt, India is extraordinarily important to Facebook as a company. And to be even clear, the revenues from India, and I say it with a lot of respect, but in the spirit of openness, the revenues from India is today a small percentage of global revenues of Facebook. So it doesn't come from a short-term transactional lens. I think it comes from just recognizing that, we are hugely privileged to be able to participate in India, right? I think the fact that it's an open democratic society that welcomes companies from around the world, we feel privileged that we have the ability to participate in India. That's not true in a country like China for us. That's one. I think second, we do look at India and see it in the middle of being in the middle of this dramatic, positive economic and social transformation. And for any company like Facebook that is relevant around the world and that has the ambition to have good, positive impact, the canvas for India is massive. So I think that India is right at the top of the stack for Facebook and its leadership. It shows in, you know, before I came on board, they changed the structure for India in a way that they haven't done for any other country, where they brought together all the functions under a single operating unit. India is now not part of the Asia organization. It works with Facebook headquarters directly. All of it, I think, and what I've seen is the appetite to invest in India is enormous. It is an open checkbook. And I think it all comes from not the short-term transactional lens of how much revenues or profits can we make, but from the canvas that we see for the long term in terms of being able to really play a positive role in what is clearly one of the outlier standout social and economic transformations of the century.
So slightly, you might find this question a little facetious, but I think a serious question. To what extent does the large number of employees of Indian origin at Facebook influence this great interest in India?
I think it's true for tech companies around the world. I think there really clearly is a connect between Indian tech entrepreneurs who have done well around the world and bringing in a level of empathy and a sense of connectedness to India. My sense is that accentuates it. I think the interest and excitement for India is secular, but the fact that there is an appreciation for the special talent that comes from India, whether it's product managers, engineers, leaders. I think that adds to the story, and I think it's a good thing. We should leverage that empathy.
Secular is, means across the board here. It's used in a generic sense, not yes. the political sense here. Otherwise, tomorrow there'll be something that, you know, face, Mark
you,
Zuckerberg's India rep says he stands for secularism in India. That will be the headline tomorrow.
Thank you so for that.
Thank you very much. Ajit, you know, he mentioned to you that he ran Hotstar earlier. I spend a lot more time on Hotstar, enormously more than on any OTT platform, and definitely than on Facebook. And I do it all to watch sport. And I'm
love to get both of you on Facebook.
And
or
I'm very happy. I'm very happy to know. I was told last night that he's bringing a lot of sport, including cricket, onto Facebook. So I think that people like me who have not been, who've not learned to use Facebook so much, also now will end up there. So thank you very much, Ajit.
You were
very candid and very forthcoming. So applause for our guest.